Great. Well, thank you very much. Wanted to take you a little bit through what we've been doing for the last few years. We really think of ourselves as part of the progression of video programming brands, where broadcasters came from radio to do broadcast television, then came the cable networks, and now we're seeing internet-based video programming brands like Hulu and Vivo and Machinima and a bunch of others that are arising from the internet and creating really interesting opportunities. Number one, for example, most of these brands are instantly global, and because of that, it gives us a big ability to scale. And secondly, because of the proliferation of all the video-enabled devices that we've seen, such as smartphones and tablets and connected televisions, that is really the model. So we are about showing up where the audience wants to see content on TV, on laptops, tablets like the iPad, and certainly on smartphones as well. We have grown a significant audience. In May, we delivered over 1.7 billion video views for the month of May to almost 180 million people around the world. We're virtually in every single country with the exception of China for the moment. And obviously we're hitting over 70 million video views per day to about 14.5 million people on a daily basis. We have also among the strongest, in fact, the strongest engagement metrics, meaning how much time people spend, how many video views they actually watch, among a lot of different types of video categories, including Vivo and Viacom and AOL, Yahoo, Microsoft, Facebook, et cetera. Our audience is really focused on 18 to 34-year-olds. In the advertising world, they're often called the lost boys because the question is, how do you actually reach them? We know they're in huge numbers online, more difficult to aggregate in other areas. Obviously, very influential to the culture. We're seeing the whole Comic-Con culture and big movies, big games, et cetera. The biggest entertainment event in history happened last November, Modern Warfare 3. That was driven by this kind of audience as well. Our overall programming model is based right now on kind of four components. One is a user-generated. So one of the things that's different about these networks than the television model is that we embrace the user-generated community as well as the professional community. So we have a network of 4,500 channel partners from around the world that do everything from very core gaming type of things to comedies and dramas and all sorts of other content. Then we have shows that we produce in what we call core, which is really the gaming side. And then we have this prime, which is really looking at kinds of content that gamers would like, but it's not necessarily gaming, episodic narrative, sports, other types of content. And then XP, which will launch next year, which is a subscription service. One of the things that I think is really amazing about what we've seen Hulu do, for example, is the idea of a free ad-supported video programming brand connected to a subscription video programming brand. We've never really seen that in the world of television. That's really new. And the platform that we've really built on top of, which is YouTube, the other thing we've never seen is a single video platform that reaches 850 million people on almost every single device around the planet. No one has ever created a satellite service or a cable network, a cable model of that scale before. So, you know, our overall strategy is really obviously driving monetization, ad sales, transactions, those kinds of things. Our first focus, of course, was on advertising. Expand across devices, meaning we have to be on every device that our consumer cares about, whether it's a television set, mobile device, tablet. Clearly, we think of the big giant platforms on the internet as really the things that matter more so than the web in our case. So we think of YouTube, Facebook, iOS, Android, and then of course in our particular case things like the Xbox are really important to our audience. And then international, that's a big focus for us right now. We have about 50% of our audiences outside the United States, but it's mostly English language programming. So we're really beginning to focus on French language programming in France, German language programming in Germany, et cetera, to really help the global model. And then, of course, there could be other content verticals in the future, like action sports and extreme fighting and things like that. So we think of ourselves really in two different disruptive models at the same time, because we happen to be in gaming. One that's actually happening is in gaming itself, from first-person shooter kind of console games to actually free-to-play PC-oriented games. We're marketing a game called Hawken. kind of an interesting model how it got developed. Basically, four or five gamer developers created a prototype. They made a video out of that prototype. They put it up on YouTube. That video got a huge number of huge traction with our audience, and they were able to get venture financing for their company, and now that game is being built and will be released in December as a free-to-play first-person shooter type of game. The other opportunity that we've actually seen really happened to us, which is Mortal Kombat. This is a very interesting story from a creative perspective, because Kevin Tanchron is a director in Hollywood that was doing dance and choreography type videos, and he did a short film called Mortal Kombat, which was based on the game, that he wanted to show that he could actually do action. When he did that film, he put it up on YouTube. It did a lot of views. It was, you know, Warner Brothers called him up. The first phone call was to say, to cease and desist, that they were going to sue him because he actually, it's their IP. But really, they ultimately brought him in to talk, and they wanted to understand what was happening. And he said, listen, if we make a 90-minute film, break it into 10 episodes, put it on Machinima, we'll get huge numbers. So that's exactly what happened. We're told that it was the most successful web series of all time, and then that led to his being able to direct a movie for Warner Brothers, which he's in the process of doing right now. So really, we saw content development of major franchises come up in a more organic way, more like a web model. And this is a video that I'll show you now, which is a little bit about our episodic narrative process. Can we have more volume?
Order.
You said you can explain it 99 out of 100 times. What about the 100th time?
Little green men.
I'm gonna go help that guy because it's the right thing to do. You two can do what you want, but survival's gonna be a hell of a lot harder if I die out there.
That's an example of the kind of episodic narrative that we're really focusing on, that is being incubated on YouTube and has opportunities to grow an audience on an international basis. So thanks.
Thanks very much.
Thank you, everyone.
I mean, what you guys have done at Machinima is pretty impressive. You're getting a lot of investing. You're getting a lot of people that are really interested in the... Could you talk a little bit about how Machinima started, like what it really is, this whole background of using VCRs to record gameplay?
So Machinima, the term is machine cinema, and the origins was a movement that had to do with using game engines and the assets inside of games to create content. And then we started on, when we went onto YouTube, we started with just the game Halo and tried to figure out, well, what was all the programming model that would really make that work? And then we expanded it out to other shooter type games. And now, of course, the brand means really it's more of a gamer attitude. So it's not just core gaming, but as you can see, we did a show called Receiver, which is a science fiction series that has nothing to do with gaming. But again, it's what the audience likes. So if you think about sort of gamer and the entire Comic-Con type audience, that's really the connection.
How do you use data to determine what kind of content you provide to your audience?
Well, I mean, I think data is really important in the sense that it helps us understand. And this model of being able to incubate a short that then could turn into a web series, that then could turn into some sort of franchise, that's really this idea of using kind of a web organic model to do content development really in front of your audience, as opposed to, you know, the traditional model where you spend a lot of money and then you you spend a lot of money marketing it, and you hope that something happens.
So what are the numbers, cutoffs? They're saying 100,000 is the new million on YouTube. It's so fragmented on YouTube that it's very difficult to get views. It's very difficult to get noticed on YouTube. How are you guys doing that? Is it just the channel views? And what's a cutoff for you? What do you consider as a good video? Something getting a million, or is it something getting 10,000?
Well, you can think about it in two different directions. An individual video, you know, 100,000, 500,000 millions, you know, that's obviously good. And then you can think about it on the aggregate, the long tail. So if you have a lot of videos at 50,000, 25,000, mm-hmm. that's also okay. So you can think about it kind of in both directions.
And my last question is that when people come to your channel, because channels are such a big part of where YouTube is going, this idea of the television moving onto the internet, how do you determine when people come to your channel, What are they actually looking for? What do you place in there to make sure that you know what they're looking for?
Yeah, so the YouTube model is different because a lot of it is driven by search or by embeds. You get an email from somebody, watch this, and you watch it, and then all of a sudden you see that there's something you like. YouTube is the second largest search engine on the mm-hmm. web, so search ends up driving a bunch of it, recommendations, and then also how we promote specifically. So we can annotate videos that say, go watch this, or watch something. So there's three or four different things that traditionally you use to drive the numbers.
So discovery is a big part of what you guys do.
Yeah, but the traditional discovery of like the front page of something with channels on it isn't really what YouTube was really built on. And originally, they're trying to make more of that work, and I think a lot of they're going to make a lot of progress in that. But networks like ourselves and others have learned to drive big numbers even without that.
Let's go to the audience quickly. Any quick questions out there for Alan DeBevoise from Machinima? Yes, one right here. Let me just pop down and give you one of these.
Are you investing in any of your own original content?
Yeah, so that kind of model that we saw with the short going to a video series is kind of how we're doing it. We're looking at looking at a number. We have a shorts program which is going on right now where we're funding some shorts from different directors that want to try to create series. If those work, then we actually put more, we'll make a series out of that, and that works, we'll do more. We've had a lot of interest from traditional media companies and networks in the United States and elsewhere on that model, because we think it could really change the face of development, right? Because in this case, you're actually getting numbers with your development as opposed to a screenplay or a television play somewhere that's in behind closed doors, if you will.
Let's have a round of applause for Alan. Thank you very much for
coming.
I really appreciate it. Up next.